If you have your Bible, open it up to Exodus chapter 20. I looked and there was probably over 70, 80 people watching online right now. And just, you know, I thought back to the days when I remember as a boy talking about the church would be full and then people would be watching through the windows, the worship service gathered around the outside of the church. Well, they're watching through the windows now. It's just different kinds of windows, right? It's a computer screens, and they're a part of this service. They're just sitting further back. We're all gathered around the same truth. We're worshiping the same God. And so do me a favor and let's welcome those watching online this morning. Thank you for tuning in, and try your best to make this as much of an engaging worship service as you can. If you are watching online, let me encourage you, let us know where you're watching from. What city are you watching from? So that we can just kind of see if God is forming a cluster in any particular area, and how many of you are our people that are one day hopefully going to be back in worship with us when all of this stuff settles down for good, we hope. New normal, whatever that's going to be. Well, this week, we started back to school for so many, and FBCA here on our campus, you know, one thing I love about this church campus, it's very expensive. We've had to pay a lot of money for it, so it would be very sad if it only opened one day a week, you know, if it was only a Sunday ministry. The thing I love about this ministry is that every day of the week, there's something going on here on campus. So this week, they had their first chapel service. Now, the kids that go to our church school, some of them are here because of a commitment to a Christian education, and others are here because they just want a good education. They want to be in a place where they have a good school, smaller classes, you know, they know they're safe, variety of reasons. But not everybody who's a part of our school is necessarily coming from a churched background. Does that make sense? Some of them are coming here and they're learning about the Lord. They're learning about the things of God during their time at FBCA. So one of the little boys, I'll call him Little Johnny. Little Johnny was here and he had not been in a worship service before. So his teacher was telling him about chapel. We're going to have our first chapel service. And so in chapel, it's kind of like a little church service. We sing. I get up, and this for this one, I had the honor of speaking, and I brought a little sermonette kind of thing. And so little Johnny says, okay, that sounds cool. We're going to worship God together as a school. So Johnny gets in here. He pays attention the whole service, and then we dismiss, and little Johnny's going to go home. And I could tell he was disappointed about something. You could just see it by the look on his face. It wasn't up to his expectations. Well, he was talking to the headmaster, Miss Casely, and she talked to him there for a minute. And then after he left, she came and she spoke to me. And I could tell that whatever he said was quite humorous. So Miss Casely comes up to me and she says, well, he was not pleased with chapel today. And I said, why is that? She said, because when he heard we were going to worship God, he expected God to literally be here where he could see him. And I thought to myself, what an appropriate illustration to open up today's text with. We're talking about the second commandment, which is make no graven images. Don't try to make any kind of visible expression of the unseen God. Little girl was in class one day, and teacher walks over, looks over her shoulder, and she said, Sally, what are you drawing? And Sally looks up and says, I'm drawing God. Teacher says, Sally, honey, God is invisible. No one knows what God looks like. She says, well, they will when I finish my drawing. That is one of the things that God says. On one hand, it's a very natural desire to want to see the thing that we're singing to, the person we're singing to. But it's something, it's a desire that you are supposed to resist. Why is that? Well, the first command was concerned with the object of our worship, have no other gods before me. The second command is more concerned with the manner of our worship. It's how we worship the one true God. The God of the universe is spirit. You can't see spiritual reality with physical eyes. So what do? We have a tendency to help God out a little. And we make an image, an idol, an icon that will give us something to gaze upon as we worship. It's very human to do that, and it's very wrong for multiple reasons. I'm going to show you why in the text today. There's three things the text shows us. It shows us a law to live. It shows us a Lord to love. And thirdly, a legacy to leave. Let's look first at the law that we are to live. Look at verse 4. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in the heaven above or in the earth beneath or in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them. Notice the connection between the graven image, the thing that's formed, and worship. God is not saying, don't make statues. God is not saying, do not produce art. He's not even saying, don't involve it in worship from time to time. As a matter of fact, you know, one of the keys to interpreting the Scripture is to let the Scripture interpret itself. So if you want to understand a text, look for the greater context. Later in this same book, the Bible tells us, or actually in the same story in Deuteronomy, it tells us that the Spirit of God will come upon one of the workers of the temple and will enable him to produce beautiful architecture and beautiful art for the tabernacle, or what would later become the temple. The temple is just a permanent version of the tabernacle. He would embroider on the curtains of the temple, great images of angels. When you go inside the temple or the tabernacle, you would see palm trees on the walls that had been emblazoned. Literally, the Ark of the Covenant was just a big crate. It was a big box, and it had the Ten Commandments, a little bit of manna, and Aaron's rod that budded. But on top of that ark, there were two sculptures of angels, and their wings touched in the middle, right over the mercy seat. So how is that okay, but God is saying here, don't make any representation of anything like that. How can you have one without the other? Well, it's the connection to worship that makes it problematic. He's saying here, don't make anything to bow down and worship it. Don't make anything to help you to see the unseen God. And I'll show you why in just a moment. What he is saying is, don't try to make the unseen God visible. In a few more chapters, we're going to see that while Moses is up on the mountain meeting with Yahweh, that the people began to wonder about him. And they said, we don't know where this guy is. He might have gone into heaven for all we know. So let's do this. Let's make a visible image. We'll take all of our gold rings and all of this stuff. We'll melt it down. And Aaron, you form something that we can look at while we worship. Aaron makes the golden calf. Now, they didn't bring the golden calf out and say, behold Baal. Or if you're from the South, Baal, you know. B-A-A-L. That was a god, a little g god in Egypt. They didn't say, behold Baal. Aaron made the golden calf, which was the idol that represented the false god Baal, and he said, behold Yahweh. This is the God that brought you out of Egypt. And he later goes on to say, this is Yahweh. This is Jehovah. This is the God of the Bible. So what he's trying to do is to say, I'm going to help the worshiper imagine the thing that they worship. Now, inevitably, when you do that, the idol becomes the object of worship. And it's problematic for a number of reasons. For one, it always conceals more than it reveals. If you take that idol, and let's say if you say this golden calf, it represents the strength and the power of Yahweh. So look upon it and think of how strong Yahweh is. But how can the idol represent the sacrificial nature of Yahweh? How can it represent the meek and approachable, the loving, the gracious, merciful nature of Yahweh. It's the same way with a painting. The tradition of churches like ours, evangelical churches, Protestant churches, is you don't see a lot of artwork at all. They're pretty much bare wall buildings. Now, that's not all good. It wouldn't hurt to have a little more artwork on display, because God the Creator took no material. He spoke ex nihilo. He spoke out of nothing and created things. He brought order out of chaos, and He created beauty and put them on display. We reflect His image by taking things that He has made, reordering them, producing art, and it's a very good thing. It's a godly thing, and it wouldn't hurt to have a little more art in a worship center. However, the reason you don't see depictions like pictures of Jesus in Protestant churches very often, you'll see crosses, but you don't see Jesus on the cross in a Protestant church. The reason for that, anytime you depict Jesus, first of all, have you ever noticed it always seems to look like the one that made it? Like if you see a picture of Jesus made by a European, he's blonde hair, blue-eyed, has wavy blonde hair, you know, and he doesn't look very Jewish. Have you ever noticed that? It tends to be an impression of ourself that we project upon Jesus. But also, have you ever noticed you can project one quality of Jesus, but you're concealing other qualities? If you show Jesus smiling, if you've noticed, there's not many pictures of Jesus with a smile on his face, even though the Scripture says he was anointed with the oil of joy more than his companions. You rarely see Jesus smile. If you see Jesus smile, you're concealing the fact that he is a righteous judge. And he's, cleansed the money changers, drove them out of the temple with a whip. I mean, he's a wrathful, furious judge at times. If you present him as a wrathful, furious judge, you conceal the fact that little kids would run up to him and jump in his lap. And he was very meek and mild and approachable. So, an idol that's created not so much to direct your attention to another god, they're always created to help you worship the true God, but they have a tendency to cover up or conceal more than the one thing, one or two things that they reveal. So don't try to make the unseen God visible. Don't project your impression of God. The word image, he says, do not make a graven or carved image. In the Hebrew, shares the same root word with the word imagine or imagination. There has to be something imagined before it can be imaged. Every artist begins with the end in mind. The good ones. They have an idea of what they're going for, and then they project it onto the canvas. The sculptor, there was a sculptor, he was sculpting some great king, and someone asked the sculptor, how do you produce the sculpture of the king out of that piece of stone? He says, I just knock away everything that doesn't look like the king. So he's got an image in his mind of what the king looks like, and he removes anything that doesn't look like the king. So in the same way, we have an idea, we're imagining what God looks like or what God is, and then we project that onto the idol. Do you see how it works? The imagination precedes the image. He's warning us here to not let our imagination produce our concept of reality, but let the truth of how God has presented himself shape our imagination. Now, the first aspect of this command, don't make a graven image, I doubt very many of you are guilty of that. This may be the one Sunday you come to church and think, I scored an A today. You know, I've not produced a single graven image in all my life. However, the deeper implication of it, don't come up with an idea of who God is that is not informed by the truth. It's something our culture is very guilty of. Anytime we say, I like to think of God as, and then you fill in the blank. If that is not a reflection, if you're pretty much, if you're not quoting a verse after that, we have a problem. Well, my God would never send someone to hell forever and forever and forever. Well, your God is not the God of Scripture. I'm very sorry to tell you that, but it's just the truth. Well, my God would never say that all sex outside of marriage is wrong. Well, the God of the Bible says that. And see, what we do, if we come up with an idea of who God is that does not line up with how God has presented himself in Scripture, we're doing God a great disservice and we are breaking the second commandment. It's the same way in interpersonal relationships. You can't really have a relationship with somebody until you look at them for who they really are. If I project an image on you that is not how you've conceived of yourself or how you present yourself, you come in today and you're dressed up in red and black. You're a Georgia Bulldog and you're representing your team. And I say, I like to think of you as a Florida Gator. Depending on how far the inaccuracy goes, it's going to be really hard for us to get along, isn't it? You come in, you say, maybe you're a Biden fan, and I say, I like to think of you as a Republican. You're probably not going to receive that very well. I've got to receive you for who you are if you and I are going to get along. And so many times in marriage, this is where people go wrong. They walk into the pastor's office. I'm telling you, one of the biggest waste of times is premarital counseling. They hear nothing I say. Glad to do it. The scriptures, I pray the scriptures will haunt them one day, but they've got those rose-colored glasses on. I mean, you've been there. You remember those days. You're just in love. And you know, you're trying to talk about budgets, and you're trying to talk about plans, and he's not got around to the budget yet, but it's going to be fine. But tell that to the utility company, you know what I mean? It doesn't work that way, but it's going to be fine. Here's what often is going on. He is in love with an image that she can never live up to. Or perhaps she's in love with an image that he can never live up to. Sometimes they're not even in the ballpark of the same image. Now, I believe, I'm convinced that this is true, that even in those circumstances, they can ultimately make it work. But eventually, usually about 3 years into marriage, when they realize he's never going to be what she thought she was committing to. And she's never going to be what she thought she fell in love with. Once they realize that, if they will begin to say, okay, now who are you? They will typically still be in love. But it's got to be honest. You married an athlete, you don't look at him and go, well, I like to think of you as an artist. I'm sorry, he can't paint. He doesn't sing. You know, I mean, I like to think of you as, you know, for us to have a relationship, as long as I think of you as something different than what you really are, we never will have a good relationship. When I first began in ministry, I was at a great seminary, and I had these heroes who were seminary professors, and I wanted to preach my sermons in a way that would impress them. And so I would make them so deep, they were almost incomprehensible. An older gentleman came up to me one time and he said, you know, Professor so-and-so would be really impressed with that sermon. He said, but the fact is, he wasn't here and he's not going to listen to it online. He will never probably hear you preach. Eventually, why don't you think about the church you do have rather than the one you wish you had? And I began to look at it and go, you know what I've got here at Garrett County, Kentucky, Lancaster Baptist Church. I had a lot of farmers. They were tobacco farmers predominantly. So I had to figure out something about those folks. And as soon as I began to receive them for who they were and not who I imagined them to be, our relationship took off. If it's that way, if you as a human expect people to relate to you as you really are, how dare you cast your impressions of who you wish God to be upon him? Look at the Word of God. see how he reveals himself, and say, well, it is what it is. God is who God says he is. I'm going to receive him and worship him for who I am rather than imagine some concept of God that is inaccurate and then image it into an idol that I actually worship. I'm going to show you why that could be detrimental if you don't get this right in just a moment. But that's the law that you are to live. Secondly, not only the law that you are to live, notice secondly, the Lord that you are to love. In verse 5, it says, "For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God." Now, if you read that verse, especially, I thank God, one of my favorite things about this church are people who are relatively new to the faith. We're growing, we've got the core group, but we've got this outer shell of people who are just kind of coming into the faith, and they're just learning. This is one of those verses you have problems with when you first start delving into Christianity. Oprah Winfrey, as a matter of fact, says this is why she is not a classically described Christian. She considers herself a Christian, but she's more of a New Age version of Christianity, which projects, that breaks this commandment and projects a version of God as they wish him to be, rather than going to the truth. She says this verse is what knocked her out of Christianity. She said, why would God be jealous? Is he jealous of my house? Is he jealous of my car? What is God jealous of? If you understand it that way, you're going to have that same trouble. You're going to struggle the same way she did. I believe that every person, every human being is beautiful to somebody. I mean, I believe they're knockout gorgeous to somebody. Now, you may look at some and say, I don't find them attractive at all. But I believe, not because the Scripture necessarily teaches this, just observation. I've seen people that to me were not classically attractive at all, but somebody sees them and they are just absolutely their type. It's as if he's been looking for that his whole life. Now, I married my wife because I found that she was exactly my type. She was exactly what I was hoping for and praying for, and I find her very, very attractive. I would expect other people to find her attractive as well. I'm not jealous of that. That doesn't give me trouble. But if her heart begins to give to others what was only intended for me, that's where jealousy comes in a righteous way. Does that make sense? You see the difference in those two? So God, it's not like God says, well, I'm jealous over Zeus. I wish I was as strong as Thor. It's not like that at all. God is not concerned about anything else. He created everything that is. But God is saying, I'm jealous over your affection and your attention. I created you. I knit you together in your mother's womb. I bought you with a great price. I've given my all in love to you. And he wants you to love him back. And when you put anything else in priority over him, that's when he says, I'm a jealous God. I want your worship. I created you to worship me. Here's what I've observed in my own life, and you probably have seen it in yours as well. If my heart begins to disorder or disorganize anything in life, God will do one of two things. He will either sabotage that thing that I'm worshiping, or he will sabotage my ability to enjoy that thing that I'm worshiping. Let's say, for example, when I moved down here from Alabama, I had a great boat. But I learned that boats can be great as long as you have them and they don't have you. Have you ever heard anybody say that there's two great days in a man's life, the day he buys his boat and the day he gets rid of it finally? If I ever began to neglect my time with God, neglect my giving, neglect my service and volunteering for the Lord so that I could basically worship my boat, ironically, the boat would have trouble almost every single time. Now, I'm not saying if your boat's got motor problems, you're in sin. I'm not saying that. Some of you are just cheap. You bought a cheap boat. That's your problem. But this was a good boat. But if I disordered my affection, God loved me enough to show me the reality of my idolatry. And from time to time, it seemed he would sabotage the idol. If he didn't do that, it seemed he would sabotage my ability to enjoy the idol. You see, the Bible says that God both gives wealth and he gives you the ability to enjoy it, or he withholds it from you. I've seen people that they prayed for children for years, and then God gave them a baby. And the next thing you know, that baby became the center of their life, and they put that baby ahead of the Lord. That kid gets a little bit older, and he's on the Jerry Springer show. What happens? The Bible says, in the book of Malachi, look it up, it says God has the ability to turn a blessing into a curse. You can so want something and get it and put it so quickly ahead of God in your affection that very thing that you prayed for decades can be the worst thing to ever happen to you. There's a story in the Old Testament. The son of the king, the prince of Israel, wanted to have an audience with the general of Israel, Joab, Absalom. Absalom sends for Joab. Joab ignores the invitation. So once again, the prince of Israel calls for an audience with Joab. Joab, again, ignores the invitation. A third time, he calls for an audience with Joab. Joab refuses the invitation. Absalom says to his servant, "Do you see the barley field next to the house of Joab? Burn it." The next verse says, "And Joab appeared before Absalom." From time to time, God will burn our barley fields to get our attention. If we become idolatrous and we're truly saved, we're truly loving God, we've truly been born again, but we begin to let vehicles, jobs, relationships, hobbies, toys, you name it, get disproportionate in our life to our worship of Him, there's a tendency for Him to strike a match and burn the barley field. And that should get our attention. The next thing you know, and some of you have been there, some of you are there right now, you couldn't find time to pray, but COVID came knocking. You had plenty of time to pray then, didn't you? There's something about it when he sabotages the idol or our ability to enjoy it. You get in your dream home, you neglect God, you get in your dream home, and there it is. And you just stand in the front yard saying, "Would you just do something? Make me happy." And it's powerless. It's powerless to change you. It's powerless to add value to your life. Now, the inverse of that is very true. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. You reorder your worship and put Him first in your life. You turn your back on the idols, and suddenly that thing that used to be an idol can now be a blessing. Now, if you don't care anymore because your life is fulfilled in Jesus Christ, well, He can give you the relationships, and they won't become idolatrous to you. But you understand, if you are looking for another person to fulfill your heart, that's something they are absolutely incapable of doing. And God may wait till you say, "I am fulfilled in Jesus Christ and Him alone." And then He says, "Now I can trust you with a relationship. Or I can trust you with the bass boat. I can trust you with that job opportunity," whatever it may be. But He loves you too much to allow the idol to rule and to reign in your heart. Number three, there's a law to live. There's a Lord to love. Number three, there's a legacy to leave. Now, this next passage is going to come up time and time again, and it is one of the most misunderstood passages in the Old Testament. And it's in there a lot, so you need to kind of understand what he's saying. It says in 5C, it says, "Visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments." Now, at first reading, it seems to be saying God's going to punish the children for the father's crime. That's not at all what it's saying. He's not presenting some generational curse theology right here. Now, there is a tendency, just genetically, for if you have, if the father has certain tendencies, weaknesses, maybe if there's substance abuse in a family, alcoholism, drug abuse, you name it. If genetically there's predisposed to certain weaknesses, it's not uncommon at all for the children to have that, those same predispositions. And so you have to be very, very careful in those areas. But what he is saying here is there's something about idolatry that's very easy to inherit. He would not punish you for your father's sins. As a matter of fact, in Deuteronomy, he says, never let it be said in Israel that the fathers ate sour grapes and the children's teeth were set on edge. He says, never think each man will pay for his own sin. That's what Scripture teaches. Either they'll pay for it or Christ will. But somebody's got to pay for it. It will not be the children paying for their father's sins. It'll be the children paying for their own sins. There's something about idolatry, if you don't deal with it, you will unintentionally raise a generation of idolaters. What the father's compromise, the father's compromise become the children's excesses. The little compromises in the dad's life become the idols in the son's life or the daughter's. The things when we sow the wind, in the next generation, we tend to reap a hurricane. Be very careful about passing idolatry down to your children. Be very careful that you don't sacrifice your children on the altar of your idol. What does that mean? Let's get as clear as we can be. We start a business. The business grows. The next thing you know, we're neglecting church. We're neglecting youth group. We're neglecting our quiet times. We're putting God over to the side so that we can pursue a career. And we excuse it and we say, but look what vacations we can take and look what homes we can build and look at all these things. While in our hearts and in our minds, we love God, we truly do, but we're trying to keep up with something that's become an idol in our life. And then we don't understand when our kids are grown and gone why they don't even want to go to church. They're just always worshiping at the idol's temple. The idol's the job. The idol is whatever it was that you compromised in. Have you lived long enough to see that that's just the norm? That the compromises of the fathers tend to be the excesses of the sons. There's something about idolatry that's so easy to inherit. You're not forced to inherit it, but it will almost always come knocking if you've been raised in that environment. It's very important as parents that we serve our children by keeping first things first. It's very important that we begin to look at things and say, listen, the arts are wonderful. Theater's wonderful. Sports are wonderful. All that's good, but none of that's God. And you'll see later things like the command to the Sabbath. It puts a governor on our tendencies. By honoring the Sabbath and remembering the Sabbath day to keep it holy, that tendency for us to want to go out and generate wealth 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, we're intentionally shutting it down by saying, I'm going to focus on God one day in seven. I'm going to give Him my undistracted attention rather than pursue a dollar everywhere I turn. And in everything in your life, you have to intentionally create some margin where you remind that thing who God is. And then suddenly it can become a blessing rather than a curse in your life. Well, ultimately, the main reason why God says you shouldn't go out, even though like the little boy in chapel, you want to see God. Even though, like the little girl in school, you want to draw a picture and know exactly what God looks like, the reason God commands you not to do it primarily is because God says, I'm going to give you an image that's far better than anything you would conceptualize. In the book of Colossians, we read that Jesus is the image of the unseen God. Jesus says, when you see me, you've seen the Father. In the beginning was the Word. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory. Glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. There's not a statue that can do that. There's not an icon that can do that. There's not a stained glass window that can present Jesus to you the way Jesus himself can. He says, if you want to know what God is like, don't conceptualize it in your mind and say, well, I like to think of God as... If you want to know what God is like, look at Jesus Christ. He says, when you see me, have you not seen the Father, is what he said to his disciples. And here's what will inevitably happen. If you put your face in God's word long enough, eventually any self-created imaginary view of Jesus that you have will inevitably clash against the real Jesus. And you'll have to pick a team. Judas, I believe, was an idolater. I'm going to show you why. Judas Iscariot had an idea. He was very politically active. He was called a zealot. Now, there was nothing wrong with being a zealot, but it painted everything in his life. He was kind of the single-issue voter that everything is colored by that one thing. So when he thought of the Messiah, he assumed Messiah, he imagined Messiah would look at the world the way he looked at it. The zealots wanted Rome out of Israel. They wanted to reestablish the Davidic kingdom. And they wanted to have that temple worship rocking there on the mountaintop and David ruling and reigning, or David's ancestor ruling and reigning, and Rome defeated and banished out of the land. So Jesus comes along. Jesus is feeding the multitude. He's walking on the water. He's raising the dead. It looks like all of Judas's dreams are coming true in the person of Jesus Christ. It came that final week. Jesus makes his triumphal entry through the lion's gate in the city of Jerusalem. As he's riding in on the donkey, the people are waving the palm branches, singing Hosanna, throwing their cloaks down for his colt to walk upon. Judas probably had every expectation that Jesus would enter in through the lion's gate, take an immediate right, and go into Fort Antonius and cast out that legion of Roman centurions that was stationed there. But when Jesus crossed through the gate, he didn't go to Fort Antonius. He went to his father's house, the temple, and he drove out the money changers. Wasn't at all what Judas expected. And it's about that time that Judas realizes his imagination of Jesus had clashed against the reality of Jesus. And he had to pick a team. The Pharisees sweetened the deal with 30 pieces of silver, and he made his choice. Be very careful of falling into the trap of saying, my God would never look at that person and say, just because they're not a Christian, that they're going to go to hell. Be very careful about that. Be very careful of saying, my God would never say that what those two people who love each other are doing is wrong and an abomination. Are you sure about that? If that's the truth, then your God is not the God of Scripture. And one day the God of Scripture and your imaginary God are going to clash, and you're going to have to choose one. When they clash, the Bible says, no man can serve two masters, for he will love the one and hate the other, or he will cleave to the one and despise the other. You're going to have to pick a team. So what we should do today is, in our heart and in our mind, cast down any ungodly, unscriptural imagination we may have of God, and recommit ourselves to looking to God's word and saying, Lord, I want to worship you for who you are as you reveal yourself to me through the truth. And as you do, then and only then, can a real relationship be developed between you and your Creator. Let's bow our head and close our eyes. Father, would you search our heart today? As Martin Luther said, the heart, the human heart, is an idol factory. We can produce an idol out of anything. So we probably have some we don't even know about. Lord, would you search our heart and show us if there's anything in our heart that's become too big, that's become misappropriated, that's sitting on your throne. And Father, give us the courage and the wisdom and the strength and the faith to wage war against the idols of our heart. Father, if there's any tendency in our mind for us to create a God in our own image, Father, would you enable us, Lord, to recognize it? And would you enable us to wage war against that tendency and to say, we will worship our Lord, our Creator, for who He is and how He's presented Himself in the Scriptures, rather than what our politically correct culture desires for Him to be. Help us to be brave in doing that, Lord. Father, there are some here today that don't know you yet. Maybe they know an image that's not even like you, and they've worshiped it. Father, would you make that clear to them so that they can embrace you through your Son, Jesus Christ? Father, there are those perhaps that they've so tried to develop a relationship on their own, apart from a church. And Father, they've fallen into the trap of conceptualizing a deity rather than hearing your truth and worshiping you in a response to that. Father, that's why you want us to be a part of a local New Testament church. Lord, some of those watching online right now, they need to be a part of a church. They can watch online, but they need to still be a part. They need to support and give and serve. Maybe even some watching online would reach out to us and say, how can I join? Father, there may be some here this morning that they need to unite with our family of faith. Would you give them the courage to obey you in that area? And Father, this time is yours. We're here to worship and serve you. You do what you see fit. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's stand to our feet. If God's leading you to make a public decision.